Standard Super League Week 2.
Oh, wow. Look,
what the hell? Wow. Just always. All right. So there you go. Gabby Sparts, how are you doing?
I am good. How are you, Paul?
A little bit salty, I guess. I expected to. I was hoping that we'd have some good matches, but you just beat the crap out of me in games 2 and 3. How does that make you feel?
Oh no, I can't hear you.
Oh, you can't?
Oh. Technical difficulty.
Technical difficulties, but you can just.
Sorry, you kind of.
You can just smile and rest on your laurels.
And bask in your victory.
Yeah.
It's cutting out, so I didn't really hear you, but I heard that there would be some sick Robins here.
That's why you're here. Yeah, yeah. I mean, you after, so for those of you guys who don't know, Standard Super League Week 2 happened yesterday, and I got to battle against Gabby Sparts, and once again, Gabby was victorious over Esper Dragons, and you are now locked to move on to the next round.
Okay, you're 2-0 now?
Yeah, I'm 2-0.
And what are the others? So you're 1-1, Paul.
I am 1-1.
Is there?
Yeah. So Paul is 1-1, and Marshall's 1-1, and Kenji's 0-2.
Okay. So you versus Marshall play for the second spot. Is that what's happening? Or did you already play Marshall?
So I play Marshall in the Esper Mirror.
Yeah.
But he's got.
Yeah, they're gonna play the Esper Mirror.
But he's got more cyber cards, so it's gonna be kind of tough. He's got an extra Dragon Lord's Prerogative, which is great.
Big deal.
And he has an extra Jace, which is medium. But the extra Dragon Lord's Prerogative. In the mirror, it's like not that many cards matter. And Prerogative is one of the most important cards in the matchup. And the fact that he has a second one. I didn't expect anybody, actually, maybe that was my fault, but I didn't expect anybody from my bracket to be playing a blue control deck. Which is why I only went with the one Prerogative. But
now you're going to get punished for that decision.
Oh my God.
I'm rooting for Marshall so much. Marshall.
Do you think Marshall probably thought you were bringing a control deck?
Yeah, I'm sure he. I mean, that's the reason.
Did he want to play he thought I was going to play control deck, so he just chose to play a control deck?
He knows he's going to play you in the mirror. He's seen you play.
Oh my God. Yeah. I guess so. I mean, I have been defeated. But what are your thoughts on your matchup next week against Kenji, Gabby?
I'm not sure. I also see, it seems like I'm interrupting everybody because of the Skype lag, so I'm sorry if that's happening. But I think, I mean, I tried it a little bit. I actually don't think it's that bad for me. I think Kenji feels like it's pretty favorable for him, but from what I tried a little bit, it doesn't seem that bad.
Yeah, but I mean, if history is any indication, it's just going to repeat itself and Kenji's just going to go 0-3, right?
Is the matchup for next week for them?
The matchup next week for them is Gabby's playing Goblins with Obelisk Averred, and Kenji is playing Green White with Collected Company.
Okay.
So Kibler's deck, like 2 Pro Tours ago.
Sure.
Or whatever. And, you know, I mean, historically, Green White matches up pretty well against Red, but, you know, Obelisk Averred is a big game.
Big game. Really changes matchups.
Yeah, because generally
Yeah, for sure. And that's what I saw from like the very little that I tried it that I've tried it so far is that Obelisk is pretty good at kind of breaking that
right.
Yeah, the card's just very important for me to resolve.
Yeah,
it just seems like, you know, generally all of his creatures kind of outclass yours, but if you drop an Obelisk, all of a sudden you cast a Whirling Outburst and you just have 9 power on the board.
Right. You can't keep up with that.
Yeah.
So I don't know. We'll see how it goes. It would be huge if I do win because it gets me a bye, because I would win the pod. God. And that also qualifies me for the, I forget what they're called. It's like the other tournament that's happening in October. It's another league.
Yeah, it's the super league where everyone from the different leagues is bubbling up.
Yeah.
I
just misqualified.
I don't know what it's called. Yeah, let's call it the super league. We can go with that.
I'm just so jealous right now.
Paul, this is what winning looks like.
I just didn't even expect this. You know, I was already talking with Tom about all the crushing defeats that we had in Grand Prix Detroit, and then all of a sudden, bam!
You come here and you just.
Yeah, I come here and get daggered once again. Thanks, Russell. I really do appreciate it. I really do appreciate it. But Gabby, do you have any tournaments that you're planning on attending in the near future?
In the near future? There wasn't anything. Not in the near future, no. There was GP Detroit, and that was like the last GP that I have planned in the near future. I'm definitely going to go to Milwaukee and Indy, but that's kind of far away from now.
Are you going to any World Magic Cup qualifiers?
I'm not, because the one in the Midwest is like in Texas, I think.
Okay.
Huh. Not close.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There's one in Philly and there's one in...
Here and then one in Texas, I guess.
In Texas, right.
Where in Texas is it, do you know?
I have no idea. I only plan on going to the
last summer. Time it was in Indy, and the one in Indy was really easy to get to, and I'm not really interested in going to Texas to play at the WMCQ. And there's a one in Philly this weekend, but I'm not in Philly this weekend, so that's unfortunate, but that's life.
You know what was a little bit disappointing when as soon as you defeated me, I just went straight to the Twitch chat, only to just realize that pretty much 99% of the chat was rooting for you.
99% of the chat, of the world, Twitter, of this room. I mean,
there are a lot more people in the hashtag crush Cheon family than the hashtag crush Gabby family. I don't even understand why. I'm not sure what happened there.
I think I had one of my friends pointed out, but if you actually go look at the search history of crush Cheon versus crush Gabby, crush Cheon is definitely the more utilized hashtag to date. So
yeah, well, I know you're more familiar with all those stats. Yeah. All right, well,
see,
Gabby.
Even in chat right now, I don't know if you guys can see chat right now, but there's a lot of hashtag crush Cheon.
Yeah, of course there is. Of course there
is. Chat.
Yeah,
Paul.
Yeah, yeah. Oh my goodness.
Paul.
Yeah. Okay. Now you know the chat's gonna do something else.
I was just here briefly for some sick rubbins, but I will let you continue on some fun Magic TV adventures.
Yeah. Once again, thanks again for making a guest appearance just for once the sick rubbins. I do feel it in my heart, and hopefully I can join you in the next round. And best of luck next week.
Marshall.
Best of luck,
Marshall.
Paul.
Yeah. Won't need. I'm playing Marshall.
People are just going Paul now.
Yeah, of course they're going Paul.
Thanks,
all right,
Chad.
Thanks a lot, Gabby.
Thanks, Gabby.
Absolutely. Thanks, right. Paul. I'll see you, Tom.
All right, have a good one. All right, well. Can't ever win.
If only Hayden and I were there, you could have carried the Cheons for you. But...
You know, that is one thing. I lost the first round.
I was so excited to that counter run up, and then we didn't carry you a single other time, and that was unfortunate.
Yeah. Maybe it inspired me, but in Grand Prix Detroit, I lost the first round, and Hayden and Martell both won their round. So Tom obviously tweets out, had to carry Cheon. Carry Cheon count at one. And I was like, all right, well, I can't drop any more matches. And I didn't. Not for that day,
Not for that day.
Yeah.
I think we both lost two of the three that we lost, then all three of us.
We did not sequence our losses very well.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I just lost repeatedly and didn't
matter. Yeah, well, I guess me and Hayne won. Yeah, I believe I went 11-3, and Hayne went like X and 2.
Yeah, I think I started out 5-0, then lost the next 5, then won 3, and then lost 1.
Yeah. So. I mean, to be fair, we gave you had the worst deck. And Hayne had the best deck.
So. Hayne had constructed deck on day 2.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Well, his deck day 1 was also like
it was also fantastic.
Control.
Yeah.
Yeah. So there you have it. Standard Super League week 2. I will be battling against Marshall Sutcliffe next week in the Esper Dragon's Mirror. Hopefully I can take it down. He's got a couple of extra cards ready for that matchup. And Gabby Sparks will be taking on my son, Numa Tanami. If she beats Kenji, and wait.
She's the tiebreaker. So she beat Marshall and you both already, right?
Right.
So
right,
no matter
right.
what happens, even if you all both finish 2-1, she'll be the 2-1 in first because she's the head-to-head against you.
Yeah, so right? I just have to beat Marshall. Like, there's
and
no way
you get
I could...
You get the second. You cannot get the first seed out of your bracket because she has that locked.
And there's no way I can make it if I lose to Marshall because Marshall will be 2-1. All right, well, there you got...
So I think she's locked up first place coming out of your pod, you and Marshall playing for second place.
I was really hoping that we're going to get to some weird tiebreaker where one of the tiebreakers was at Lifetime Pro Points.
Was it really?
Yeah. But it was like fourth down on the list or whatever. But I guess that's not going to be happening.
You should have won.
Yeah, yeah. So next up on the panel, we have World Championships. This is a tournament that I look forward to. Hopefully, maybe next year I can qualify for it someday. You've actually had the opportunity to play in a couple times. Yep. World Championships happening in a couple of weeks. Are you, you know, involved with talking with anybody for Worlds by any chance?
I'm sort of loosely helping a couple people prep, but you know, nothing too intense.
Okay.
But you know, just kind of chiming with my thoughts on a couple topics.
Yeah, yeah. So the World Championships coming up in a few weeks. It's going to cover a lot of different different formats, you know, which has kind of been a common thing. How do you go about preparing for so many formats in such little time?
It's really tough. I mean, also, you know that you play each of the draft rounds specifically three, you know, there's three rounds of each draft. So, like, how much preparation can you really do, or do you want to allocate for just three rounds of Magic? You know, especially since it's formats you've done a lot of, you've probably drafted MTG Orange a bunch. You probably just kind of mostly skip the draft format, do a little refresher on the Modern Masters one, and then focus on Constructed.
Yeah.
And they're both known formats to some extent, so they're formats you've been playing. So you can kind of base it off of that, and just a lot of it's looking at the competitors and trying to figure out what the field's going to look like. You can kind of narrow it down. Certain people are just, you know, inclined to play certain types of decks. Make a little matrix there, figure out what you're going to come up against, and figure out what's best for that field.
Yeah, it's one of those games where it's really, really important, like, how you metagame, right? Because there's not a lot of players that are playing this tournament. It's a 24-man special invite tournament. So if you know, for example, let's say there were just 23 Wafu Tapas in the tournament, you know that they're going to be on control, and you're going to need to just bust out your mono red deck or something that crushes control.
Yep.
And I guess the same could be said for this. You know, I think, you know, people are kind of keeping it close to the vest in terms of who they're working with. I don't know. I've never tested for a tournament like this. How do you go about metagaming like that? Is that, like, super important? Like, is that one of the most important things in terms of, like, what deck you choose to play?
It is. I mean, again, you know you're not going to break the formats because these are just tested formats that people have spent a lot of time working on. So it's just trying to find the most tuned list or best position list for the field you expect and something you're comfortable playing, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
At one point we had Worlds where Modern was new. We had Raptor's Jeskai Ascendancy deck, which was actually busted. And that was awesome. I mean, wished it had been at a Pro Tour instead, because we'd rather break it for a 16-round tournament than a 4-round tournament, or 10-round tournament than a 4-round tournament.
Did you guys do well with that deck?
Yeah, the deck was fantastic.
Okay.
But I think, you know, other than that, like, that standard format is like, okay, well, we think it's going to be a lot of, like, grindy green decks, so we're going to play the Sultai Whip deck, because we think it's better against the other grindy green decks.
Right.
And it was just, you know, a lot of that sort of process of, like, how do you take one of these decks to the extreme and play that there?
Yeah. So, Shahar, two-time world champion. He has the opportunity to win three in a row. If Shahar wins three in a row, do you think people will vote him into the Hall of Fame? Three-time world champion.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know if I would. I don't know if other people. I'm having a hard time saying.
Because, you know, everybody's basing it off of Pro Tour top eights. What does a world champion victory equate to? Does a world champion victory, not just the top four, but does a world champion victory, is that like top eighting a Pro Tour?
It's not. It's just very different. I mean, top eighting a Pro Tour, I mean, again, it's a 16-round tournament against 400 top players. You know, it's just a very different kind of skill set, or not even different skill set, a different accomplishment than winning, you know, now is a 24-person tournament, but previously a 16-person tournament.
Right.
Where you have to go, you know, 10-6. Makes top eight, or makes top four. You know, now it doesn't with the 24 people. Now I think it was like X and five makes it.
Yeah.
But you know, it's,
you're allowed a lot more losses.
A lot more losses, but you're playing as much better people every round, so it's a harder tournament. You also have to get to that tournament. It's very hard to qualify.
Yeah.
So I mean, winning it is I don't know how many, you know, trying to translate it into Pro Tour top eight is the kind of thing you're out the wrong way. It's independent own very impressive accomplishment.
Right.
I don't think that, you know, it's replaces the top eight needs. I think it's something that's kind of independently. I think if you win it three times in a row, I would vote for him. I think that's a Hall of Fame level accomplishment.
Right.
Even winning it twice might already be. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, people have already kind of talked about it. I mean, Shahar is still a ways away from being eligible for Hall of Fame, but winning it three times in a row against the best of the best. Like, we know. I mean, we all know Shahar is lucky, but he's also a very good Magic player. So it's just like, at what point can you invite somebody into the Hall of Fame? This would be the first time somebody get invited, assuming Shahar doesn't ever top eight a Pro Tour, right?
I think if he wins the tournament again, I think I would have to vote for him. I think it's just unprecedented.
It's just like, it's just not. It's so unlikely to ever happen.
Again, same thing. Three-time Player of the Year, right? And maybe I can't imagine getting that accomplishment without any top eights, but you certainly get that without getting, you know, four or five.
Right.
It's things like that. They're these, like, different accomplishments you can still achieve in Magic. I think are very impressive.
Yeah.
That require you to have tremendous success in the course of a season, and demonstrate that you were one of the best players that year. And I think if you win this tournament three times in a row, that's just.
Yeah, I think that's pretty important, especially when you know people have obviously their different metrics when they're voting for Hall of Fame. It's like four Pro Tour top eights,
yeah.
and X number of finishes or whatnot. But yeah, I think what's also important, just like kind of the general perception by the pro community of how good a player is.
Sure.
You know, and you know, getting multiple player of the years or being in contention, being a top 10 player for 3 or 4 years, that's really, really impressive.
Yep.
And, you know, if Shahar, you know, wins the world championships 3 years in a row, he's basically beating the best players every year for 3 straight years.
Sure. That's, I mean, it is in one tournament each time.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? So it's, you know, it's, which is still a very impressive accomplishment.
Right.
But you look at, you know, Shouta getting into the Hall of Fame this year, where he doesn't have the Pro Tour Top 8 resume that you would expect.
Right.
People, I think voters are starting to acknowledge that you don't just, it's not purely Pro Tour Top 8s that matter, but it's a body of work. It's, you know, it's a career and other accomplishments that can get you that level of success.
Yeah, definitely. So best of luck to all the competitors for the World Championships. I have many different friends on many different teams.
Best of luck to our friends.
Yeah, best of luck to our friends. But, you know, I have a lot of friends and they're all in different teams. It's kind of awkward, right? Because, you know, there have been some years where Channel Fireball has just had like 8 members qualified.
Yep.
And they have to split up. But it's like, how do you go about doing that?
Yeah.
It's just like, well, sorry. I mean, that's just what we have to do, because it doesn't make a whole lot of sense for 8 people to all test when it's like, you know, it used to be a 16-man.
Yeah, it's half the field.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So once again, best of luck. All my friends qualified. And, you know, hope I see one of you guys holding up the trophy.
Definitely.
Could be Shahar.
Could be Shahar.
Could be Shahar. All right. Moving on to the next topic. I think we're actually going to skip this because there's not a whole lot of Zendikar previews that have come out yet.
Sure.
There have only been a handful. So, you know, when there's a few more, I believe there's several creatures now that have colored mana cost.
Yep. But are devoid of color.
But are colorless.
Yep. So it's the new mechanic, I believe it's called Devoid.
Right.
Meaning that you ignore the mana cost of their costing cost for determining their color, they're still just colorless. Interesting, you know, it's kind of a natural evolution of Eldrazi. You don't want to have them go in every deck. Well, how do you make them not do that? You make them cost colored mana.
Right.
You still have the Eldrazi, you make them colorless. So I think it's like a natural extension of that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think, you know, at one point we can have a sweet top 8 where we just go, you know, if a lot of these cards are spoiled, top 8 colorless creatures.
Sure.
And, you know, they have black and red, but they're colorless.
Yep, they'll still be eligible for that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The other thing we can just mention, I guess, is the other mechanic that they spoil, which is...
Ingest.
When you hit the other player, you get to exile cards in their library.
Yeah, that mechanic does not seem very strong.
So just, I think it just ties into, there'll be some very powerful cards that just regurgitate the ingested things. for lack of a better
ingest
term.
And regurgitate.
But like you said, the rare, right, who's just says any lands your opponents have exiled, you come into play under your control. So
okay.
If you've picked away at them with some ingest guys, you've milled a couple lands, you play this guy, they then exile 4 cards and they get all the lands.
Okay. So, you know, that makes a lot more sense, just because the effect itself, hitting somebody and milling them for 1 card just doesn't
seem very powerful. Right. But I think it's going to feed into the overall theme of the Eldrazi.
If they make some, like, you know, key rares that are going to go into some of these decks that go with, like, you know, aggressively costed creatures, maybe you can make it into a thing.
Yep.
So, you know, a lot more cards to be spoiled. Looking forward to it. And, I mean, Standard's going to change a lot.
Definitely. I mean, we'll get a big rotation.
I mean, huge rotation.
Really powerful block of cards is going away.
M15 and Theros block, correct?
Yeah.
So,
I mean, Elspeth, Thoughtseize, these, you know, Heroes Downfall cards
Master,
that have been the pillars of Standard for a long time.
Yeah.
Stormbreath Dragon, like a lot of cards that have just been defining Standard. So we're going to see room for a lot of these new. It's true. I mean, mana's going to get a lot worse. Scrylands have been a really defining part of this format. So Standard's going to change a ton. Just the rotation part, not to mention a new set coming out.
Mono red, I guess. You know, I'm sure mono red's going to be good. There's still just a bunch of good aggressive creatures, probably. Or green white, but I guess Kibler might be sad because there's no Elvish Mystic.
No Fleece Mainline, Elvish Mystic, and those are two big parts of those decks.
Yeah, yeah.
These look very, very different in a couple months, in, you know, 2 months time than they look right now.
Or just everybody's going to play 4 Hangerback Walkers.
That'll be the starting point, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because we're also losing the Shuffles It In, the Disenchant. Unravel the Aether is going to go away as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is the natural response, as well as Abzan Charm, right? We're going to lose both of those?
No.
Abzan Charm's staying.
Abzan Charm's still good.
Okay.
So Abzan Charm and Utter End will be two ways to deal with it. And I believe you also lose Perilous Vault. So Perilous Vault also
right. yep.
gets rid of it. So Hangerback Walker, hopefully they print some answers in the set, just like an emergency one. Just,
Oblivion Ring, something like that.
Yeah, that would be pretty nice. Oh, I guess, no, you lose Silk Wrap too, right?
Yes, you lose Silk Wrap
and
as well.
Vanishing Light.
Yep.
Hangerback Walker is too strong, too strong. So yeah, looking forward to more of the Zendikar previews, and you know, obviously it's a ways away, but testing for Pro Tour Milwaukee, I need to do well, but I got to learn how to draft. That's my biggest problem for sure. All right, coming up next we have the World Magic Cup qualifier, which will be hosted by Channel Fireball. It's going to be a 15K weekend.
Yep.
This is a really, really big game for somebody just looking to come down, because you know, a lot of people are just like, well, I mean, you know, I'm just going to come here and it's just going to be like a PTQ and I'm just going to travel. But now there's a 10K prize pool. So,
right.
you know, now it's just like, well, if there's not enough people, this is actually going to be like a plus EV tournament, you know? And not only, you know, I was actually briefly asked, it's like, hey, do you want to do coverage? I'm just like, being on a national team was pretty sweet. I'd love to do that again.
Yeah.
So, I you know, it's going to be really hard for me to not do that.
It's one of the things that I've never had the chance to do that I've really wanted to. Yeah. Finished second for U.S. team captain once, mm-hmm. Which was getting that close. Maybe really, you know, want it. So being on the team would be awesome. So yeah, I think I'm in the same boat. Or just this is a tournament where just the intangible prize, the non-cash prizes are so high that you really want to, you got to battle.
I'll trade you a national championship for your Pro Tour championship.
I'm good,
if you
thank
want.
You. I'll keep that one.
I'll do that. You know?
you're so generous, but I wouldn't want to scam you that way.
Yeah, I'm just saying, you know, I'm
hashtag scam artist. Yeah, work right here.
No, generous Cheon. That's the hashtag that people should be using.
Scam
anyways, yeah, so there's going to be a 10K World Magic Cup qualifier, which is going to be modern, and then I believe there's going to be a standard pre-PTQ on Sunday. So for those of you guys planning on making the trip down, make it a weekend trip, head on over to the WMCQ on Saturday and the PPTQ on Sunday. And actually, we're going to be holding WMCQ qualifiers on Friday. That's going to be held at the Channel Fireball Game Center. So that's going to be separate, a different location than where the World Magic Cup qualifier is going to be held. So make sure to go over to channelfireball.com and figure out how to get there.
Is it just for people to know, in order to qualify to be played, to play in the tournament, you need 500 yearly Planeswalker points from last year,
right?
With the season ended like May-ish, I think, and then if you didn't hit that level, then you can play in the qualifiers and spike one of those as well.
Yeah, yeah. It's not too hard. I mean, if you just play FNM every week or whatever, you should just have it. But if you don't, if you're mostly a Magic Online type grinder, then yes. You should head on over to the Channel Fireball Game Center and try to qualify there if you want to play over the weekend. So the format, modern. Haven't played at all. Is there any deck that kind of interests you? What do you think are like the top decks?
Sure. I mean, the format hasn't really changed since Charlotte, right? I mean, there've been nothing got banned, nothing got added. I mean, there's always a new set, but not a lot of modern
Hangerback Affinity.
Not something I'm very interested in doing.
Yeah.
I mean, I think the top decks stay the same as they were before, right? You're going to see Twin, you're going to see Amulet, right? You're going to see Infect, you're going to see Mono Red. I mean, you're going to see the same kind of things you've been seeing for a while. Just go back and look at the Charlotte Top 8 for your prep work. I don't think you need to do a lot more than that.
Yeah.
It's possible there's some kind of like, you know, pod derivative deck. You know, there were a couple attempts to make that.
I heard there was an Evolutionary Leap.
Right. So Leap is a card I could see fitting into those sorts of shells potentially, although obviously way less powerful, doesn't go into play.
Right.
So who knows if it's actually
It might be a little bit too dirtly, but it does seem pretty good against like the Grixis control deck.
Sure.
Right. You resolve an Evolutionary Leap and you just start just grinding out Persist creatures, like you're going to beat them in the long game. So you know,
it's very powerful with Persist, certainly.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
You know, so if you start looking at
Voice of Resurgence,
Kitchen Finks, those kind of cards, will be great in that sort of a shell. I'm sure there, you know, we have some teammates and former teammates that'll definitely be starting there.
Right.
Who, you know, the birthing pod lovers.
Wait, Sam Partey's qualified for this? No. Okay. But
Josh McClain, we'll be attempting to make that sort of a strategy.
Is World Championships going to be before the WMCQ?
So there's the one this weekend in Philly, right? Upcoming.
Right, but that's
and
standard.
Worlds is next. Oh, that one's standard. Okay.
Yeah.
So then no. So because Worlds is next weekend, and the weekend after that will be.
So then people can even look at some of kind of the innovations that the pros have come up with, and look at that as well. And you know, that's kind of one of the things with Modern. It's the format doesn't change that much, which, you know, is okay for a Grand Prix or whatever. Maybe it's okay for WMCQ, but which is kind of, I guess, the reason why a lot of pros don't like it for the Pro Tour, right?
We rehashed the topic of talking about Modern as a PT format frequently. People who love Modern get they are very defensive of this format. They want to see pros playing, and I understand that. For us, I mean, it doesn't rotate a lot, so you get these kind of and the power level is like very high. So you just get, when you miss something, you have these decks that are just depressively good. So I think it's not the best PT format, but I think it's a great world type format, great GP format.
Yeah. Or you just got to try really hard to break it, you know? And
we'll see. I mean, we'll find out next weekend if someone managed to, not this upcoming weekend, but the following weekend with Worlds, if someone managed to get there.
Oh, yeah. I'm definitely blocking off that weekend. I'm just be like, you know.
Lots of coverage.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Lisa, I'm just going to have Kyle on my lap, and maybe I'll teach him a few things when we do that. But yeah, World Magic Cup qualifier in a few weeks. I will be battling, Tom will be battling, and a lot of other people for the $10,000 cash prize pool, and of course, the chance to represent the United States in the World Magic Cup. Now we're going to be moving into our top 8 of the week.